Timor, the international community, they will simply digest East Timor and turn it into, trying to turn it into cash crop.
I mean, this is way beyond just demonstrating the subservience of the media to power. I mean, they are actual, they have real complicity in genocide in this case. The reason that the atrocities can go on is because nobody knows about them. If anyone knew about them, there'd be protests and pressure to stop them. So therefore, by suppressing the facts, the media are making a major contribution to some of the, probably the worst act of genocide since the Holocaust.
You say that what the media do is to ignore certain kinds of atrocities that are committed by us and our friends, and to play up enormously atrocities that are committed by them and our enemies. And you posit that there's a test of integrity and moral honesty, which is to have a kind of equality of treatment of corpses.
Equality of principles.
I mean, that every dead person should be in principle equal to every other dead person.
That's not what I say at all.
Well, I'm glad that's not what you say, because fact, that's not what you do.
Of course it's not what I do. Nor would I say it.
In fact,
I say the opposite. What I say is that we should be responsible for our own actions primarily.
Because your method is not only to ignore the corpses created by them, but also to ignore the corpses that are created by neither side, but which are irrelevant to your ideological
agenda. That's totally untrue.
Well, let me give you an example.
Okay.
One of your own causes that you take very seriously is the cause of the Palestinians. And a Palestinian corpse weighs very heavily on your conscience. And yet a Kurdish corpse does not.
That's not true at all. I've been involved in Kurdish support groups for years.
That's absolutely true. That's absolutely false. I mean, just ask the Kurdish, ask the people who are involved in, I mean, you know, they come to me, I sign their petitions and so on and so forth. If you look at the things we've written, I mean, let's take a look. I mean, I'm not Amnesty International. I can't do everything. I'm a single university person. But if you read, say, take a look, say, at the book that Edward Herman and I wrote on this topic. In it, we discuss three kinds of atrocities. What we called benign bloodbaths, which nobody cares about, constructive bloodbaths, which are the ones we like, and nefarious bloodbaths, which are the ones that the bad guys do. The principle that I think we ought to follow is not the one that you stated. You know, it's a very simple ethical point. You're responsible for the predictable consequences of your actions. You're not responsible for the predictable consequences of somebody else's actions. The most important thing for me and for you is to think about the consequences of your actions. What can you affect?
These are the things to keep in mind. These are not just academic exercises. We're not analyzing the media on Mars or in the 18th century or something like that. We're dealing with real human beings who are suffering and dying and being tortured and starving because of policies that we are involved in. We, as citizens of democratic societies, are directly involved in and are responsible for. And what the media are doing is ensuring that we do not act on our responsibilities and that the interests of power are served, not the needs of the suffering people and not even the needs of the American people, who would be horrified if they realized the blood that's dripping from their hands because of the way they're allowing themselves to be deluded and manipulated by the system.
What about the third world?
Well, despite everything, and it's pretty ugly and awful, these struggles are not over. The struggle for freedom and independence never is completely over. Their courage, in fact, is really remarkable and amazing. I've personally had the privilege, and it is a privilege, of witnessing it a few times in villages in Southeast Asia and Central America, and recently in the occupied West Bank, and it is astonishing to see.
And it's always amazing, at least to me it's amazing, I can't understand it. It's also very moving and very inspiring. In fact, it's kind of awe-inspiring. Now, they rely very crucially on a very slim margin for survival that's provided by dissidence and turbulence within the imperial societies. And how large that margin is for us to determine.
today's On the Spot assignment, we're going to see just what's behind the making of movies. The director and the crew are shooting a documentary film. Let's take a closer look. Bob, this word documentary, what would you say is the difference between a documentary film and a feature movie?
Well, there are a good many differences. One would be length. Generally speaking, documentaries are a good deal shorter than feature films. Also, documentaries have something to say in the way of a message. They are informational films. Also, another term that's used interchangeably with documentary is the word actuality, actuality films.
Bob, is this the thing you hold up in front of the camera before each scene?
This is a clapperboard, yes. This identifies on the visual camera the scene number and the take number, and also, as you heard, on the soundtrack. The editor back at the studio puts the two pieces of film together, matches where the lips of the clapper come together. There you are, in sync.
Before the break, you were mentioning the media putting forth the information that the power elite want. I'm not sure if I understand, how does the power elite do this, and why do we stand for it? Why does it work so well?
Okay, well, I think here we have to, I mean, there are really two questions here. One, is this picture of the media true? And there you have to look at the evidence. I mean, I've given one example, and that shouldn't convince anybody. One has to look at a lot of evidence to see whether this is true. I think anyone who investigates it will find out that the evidence to support it is simply overwhelming. In fact, it's probably one of the best supported conclusions in the social sciences. But the other question is, how does it work?
Your choice, huh? I'm the media guy. What'd you like? I got you an International Herald Tribune. You want that?
Anything in a Western language, which doesn't mean
what do you got? Financial Times?
Absolutely. That's the only paper that tells the truth.
You get the one now where they've been debating back and forth?
NRC Handelsblatt.
Yeah. Handelsblatt. Okay, that's the...
Well, this evening's program is scheduled as a debate, which puzzled me all the way through. There are some problems. One problem is that no proposition has been set forth. As I understand debate, people are supposed to advocate something and oppose something. Rather more sensibly, a topic has been proposed for discussion. The topic is manufacture of consent.
It's somewhat unusual for a member of the government to debate with a professor in public. It hasn't happened in Holland before. I don't think it's often happens elsewhere.
Mr. Bolkestein, the floor is yours.
Now, we all know that a theory can never be established merely by examples. It can only be established by showing some internal inherent logic. Professor Chomsky has not done so.
Professor Chomsky?
He's quite right when he says you can't just pick examples. You have to do them in a rational way. That's why we compared examples.
The truth is that things are not as simple as Professor Chomsky maintains. Another of Professor Chomsky's case studies concerns the treatment that Cambodia has received in the Western press. Here he goes badly off the rails.
We didn't discuss Cambodia. We compared Cambodia with East Timor, two very closely paired examples. And we gave approximately 300 pages of detail covering this in Political Economy of Human Rights, including a reference to every article we could discover about Cambodia.
Many Western intellectuals do not like to face the facts and balk at the conclusions that any untutored person would draw.
Many people are very irritated by the fact that we exposed the extraordinary deceit over Cambodia and paired it with the simultaneous suppression of the U.S.-supported ongoing atrocities in Timor.